Today, I'm excited to introduce Diane. She's the author of the widely read blog Jumper. She'll make a 50-minute presentation. We'll have a Q&A after. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my good friend, Diane Ragsdale.
Good morning. It is so great to be here. I am sincerely grateful to Center Theater Group, as well as the Irvine Foundation, for the invitation and the opportunity to speak with all of you this morning, and to all of you for showing up in the rain, which I understand can be a deterrent here, so thank you. If we let the rain get us down in Seattle, we would have never gotten any work done. So Diane Rodriguez reached out to me a while back. She had read a talk that I gave in New Zealand, sponsored by Creative New Zealand, which is an agency there, and asked if I might consider revising it for an American context, and I was really thrilled to get the invitation to do that, so thank you, Diane. It's a particular privilege to take the stage at this extraordinary institution, and this stage in particular, as the life of its visionary founder, Gordon Davidson, will be honored and celebrated this evening. As Diane knows, I'm in the throes of writing a doctoral dissertation on the relationship between the regional theater in America and Broadway. The question at the heart of my research is, what is nonprofit professional theater for? Gordon Davidson is among the early pioneers who led the movement to decentralize the American theater away from Broadway out into the regions. This was a movement that had at its core a desire to create locally relevant professional institutions that would produce, among others, important new plays and classics being overlooked by the commercial stage. Among other pioneers in the movement, Gordon Davidson stood out for producing new plays of a political nature. As Charles McNulty wrote in his moving tribute in the LA Times, theater for Davidson was an art form shouldering communal responsibilities. It was a forum for societal reflection and collective dreaming, a meeting hall for voicing of grievances and the thinking through of corrective measures. Even at its most personal, the theater, Davidson recognized, was engaged in public work. The introspection might be wholly psychological in nature, but carving out a welcoming space for this kind of meditation was a civic act. The new work Davidson shepherded at Center Theater Group reflected the way poetry and politics were entwined in his sensibility. Speaking of politics, if I dare, we're here together, a mere 11 days before a new administration will move into the White House. While I'm an American citizen and lived in the US until 2010, the past 6 years I've been based primarily in the Netherlands. Thus, I stayed up all night watching the election returns. At around 11 p.m. Eastern and 5 o'clock a.m. my time, when it began to dawn on Clinton and Trump supporters alike that, much to the collective surprise of nearly everyone, this would not be the year a woman would become president of the United States, New York Times columnist Paul Krugman posted, "We still don't know who will win the Electoral College, although as I write this, it looks incredibly as if the odds now favor Donald J. Trump. What we do know is that people like me, like most readers of the New York Times, truly didn't understand the country we live in." I posted on my blog, Jumper, a few hours later, "From where I stand, those working in nonprofit professional cultural organizations across the US, we in the so-called creative class, are without a doubt among those who did not understand our country. If we are shocked and outraged by the election results, this would only seem to prove the point." Around the same time on my Facebook feed, which is to a great extent populated by liberal arts types like me, a particular phrase from Tony Kushner's masterpieces, Angels in America, Parts 1 and 2, began to appear. That phrase, sorry, I meant to update that before, "The great work begins." The statement, both hopeful and harrowing, provoked two questions for me. First, what is our great work in the arts? I'll save that one for a little bit later. And second, why is this great work beginning only now, after Trump's election? Put another way, why does it so often take a crisis for those of us working in the arts, in the so-called civic sphere, to engage with the struggles, the pain, the hopes, the fears, the dreams of our communities at large? The extraordinary observer of the human condition, Rebecca Solnit, reflects in her beautiful book, Hope in the Dark, Americans are good at responding to crisis and then going home to let another crisis brew. She says, this is in part because, quote, we tend to think that political engagement is something for emergencies rather than, as people in many countries and Americans at other times have imagined, as part and even a pleasure of everyday life. As she puts it, the problem seldom goes home. And this, to a great extent, is what I'm here to talk about. Our problem in the arts is not going home, not in 4 years, not in 8 years, not for the foreseeable future. Why? Because our problem is existential and systemic. It has largely to do with a disconnection between nonprofit professional arts institutions in this country and their communities at large. And I'm here to argue that we have, in a sense, become part of the problem that we ostensibly exist to solve. The arts sector has been slowly walking toward a precipice for at least 3 decades. And I'm not referring to declining or aging audiences, though that is indeed troubling. In a relatively short period of time in the US, the UK, and parts of Europe, the justification for the arts has shifted from culture for the culture's sake to culture for the sake of solving social problems to culture for the economy's sake. UK arts policy wonk John Holden characterizes this as a crisis of legitimacy. Oh, sorry, I thought these slides were advancing, but they weren't, I apologize. As a crisis of legitimacy, writing, somehow, over a period of decades, politics has mislaid the essence of culture, and policy has lost sight of the real meaning of culture in people's lives and in the formation of their identities. We seem to be manifesting what Chip Ward calls the tyranny of the quantifiable, and what Dougald Hine calls a crisis of measurement. In the US and the UK, it's not hard to find evidence of this crisis. The arts are increasingly expected to pay their way or contribute to economic growth. Risk is approached as a problem rather than as inherent to the creative process. Arts organizations must continually justify their worth and account for funds in advance of spending them. There's interest in our numbers, but not really in our content. Donors want to put their names on our buildings, but have little attention for sustaining the art and culture inside them. The largest organizations are invariably seen as the most valuable in the arts ecosystem. And arts groups are expected to use business jargon and to see their communities as potential markets, their fellow citizens as potential consumers, and the culture as an exploitable product. As institutions that exist ostensibly to foster such things as beauty, meaning-making, understanding, empathy, and social cohesion, I think we need to care about this economic rationalization of what we do. Of course, the arts are not alone in this crisis. We have witnessed this retooling in almost every area of social life. That, in any event, is the thesis of Harvard political philosopher Michael Sandel, who argues in his book, What Money Can't Buy, that we have shifted from having a market economy to becoming a market society, in which, as he puts it, market relations and market incentives and market values come to dominate all aspects of life. As Sandel asks, is this the way we want to live? Put another way, are we in the arts going to let ourselves get dragged along with this retooling and embrace the market, or are we going to resist and uphold a different value system? Not by adopting a self-righteous stance bunkered within our temples of art, but by finding our humanity and helping others to find theirs. Albert Camus once wrote, "The grandeur of art is not to rise above all. On the contrary, it must blend with all." Or as social and political activist Courtney Martin says in her book, Do It Anyway, "Our charge is not to save the world after all, it is to live in it, flawed and fierce, loving and humble." This is a talk aimed at provoking you, inspiring you, I hope, to walk out into your communities with your eyes wide open and to pursue what Doug Borwick calls transformational engagement, meaning engagement with community that changes the way your organization thinks and what it does. This is not a talk about marketing strategies and practices. It's a talk about relevance. It's about matteringness. So without further ado, and that was quite a bit of ado already, I humbly share five ways to foster transformative engagement. Depending on your mission and circumstances, some of these strategies may not be appropriate, but I believe there are worthwhile lessons in each of them, and I sincerely hope that at least one is a viable means for you to increase the relevance of your organization. So, number one, let the community back in. For the past half century, there has been a working assumption that professionalization in the arts has been an unqualified good thing. But I think we need to question this idea and acknowledge what has been lost in the name of professionalization. When we professionalized, not only did we revoke, in some cases, the opportunity for citizens to express themselves as creators and makers, but more generally, we abandoned the possibility of becoming fully and completely communal organizations. One pathway to transformative engagement designed communities to let the rich, round voice of the community back in. In the US, the hands-down poster child for leading this sort of organizational transformation is the Santa Cruz Museum of Art and History, run by the visionary Nina Simon, well known, I'm sure, to many of you. Here she is giving a TED talk. Simon is a former engineer who has deployed her human-centered design skills to turn a traditional object-oriented museum into what she calls a participatory museum. Her blog, Museum 2.0, has a wealth of information on how to do this, and she has a new book out called The Art of Relevance, which I highly recommend. Here are a few other examples. The Baltimore Symphony Orchestra has created a program called Rusty Musicians, which invites hundreds of amateur instrumentalists to play alongside its professional musicians. One amateur characterized this program as life-changing. Likewise, here's a photo of 200 citizens performing alongside professionals in The Tempest as part of a program of the Public Theater in New York called Public Works. In a similar vein, a few years back, Center Theater Group co-created the production Popol Vuh with community members from the Boyle Heights neighborhood who performed alongside professional artists from El Teatro Campesino at the culmination of a year-long process that involved puppet making, performance, and music workshops. Two final examples. There we go. In 2007, the Houston Grand Opera made an extraordinary commitment to commission and produce one new opera every year, based on stories of the people and by the people of its region. One recent project called After the Storm tells the story of two massive hurricanes that hit the region 100 years apart, one of which killed more than 6,000 people. In addition to producing the opera, HGO also hosted an open mic night at a local speakeasy where local poets and storytellers and musicians performed their hurricane tales alongside members of the public. And more recently, South Coast Rep produced a two-year project called Dialogues, done in partnership with Latino Health Access, in which it interviewed 1,200 members of the Santa Ana Latino community. It's remarkable. And embarked on a process that culminated in a live performance. These are just a handful of a growing number of examples of world-class institutions designing programs to invite the community back in after decades of keeping them out in the name of professionalization. But I think there's more we can do. Nina Simon says there's a question she asks herself every time she's working on something with a participatory intent. How can I invite people, staff, volunteers, community members, to help make this project better? By all accounts, Simon's efforts have paid off. Since she became executive director of her museum, attendance has tripled, membership has increased by 50%, and more than 4,000 local artists and community groups have collaborated on exhibitions and cultural events. The museum has gone from 5 years in the red to 3 years of significant budget growth and surpluses. Simon has led an institutional turnaround based on creative risk-taking, grassroots participation, and unexpected community partnerships. It is social enterprise at its best. Imagine what could happen if you asked Nina's question of every project, every initiative, every aspect of your organization. Number two, practice radical hospitality. Quote, time and again, research reveals that the biggest barriers for a disinclined audience are indifference and low familiarity, often coupled with a perception of the organization as elitist. This, according to a report by the Wallace Foundation in the US, which has for years funded research in audience engagement. It's not hard to understand why some people feel this way if we reflect on the fact that in the US and Europe, we have perpetuated the notion that the fine or high arts are a certain kind of fare for a certain kind of people. If we want to reach non-traditional audiences, so to speak, then we need to consciously practice radical hospitality in four areas: where the art happens, what's programmed, how much we charge, and how we approach people to tell them about our work. I first encountered the term radical hospitality on the website of the theater company Mixed Blood, which uses the term to describe the philosophy underpinning its new pricing strategy, which is this: anyone can get a free admission to any Mixed Blood show any day of the week. As with other organizations that have dramatically lowered their prices, if not to free, then to something much more affordable, Mixed Blood has experienced an increase in attendance, an increase in donations, and a dramatic shift in its audience demographics, attracting those who are younger and more diverse. National Theatre of Scotland is just one of several great examples of practicing radical hospitality with place. It formed many years ago now as a theater without walls because it didn't want to limit its reach to those who lived in Glasgow or who had the time and resources to travel there. Arts organizations are increasingly experimenting with leaving their venues to produce events throughout their communities, designing their spaces to be more social, interactive, or family-friendly, inviting the public to attend rehearsals, and putting both performances and behind-the-scenes content online. One of my favorite early examples of radical hospitality in programming comes from Center Stage Theater in Baltimore. When artistic director Irene Lewis joined Center Stage in the 1990s, the theater was largely producing white plays performed by white actors for white audiences. The city of Baltimore, however, is 67% African American. Lewis felt that the theater was basically ignoring two-thirds of her community, and so she began producing two or three plays each year out of six main stage shows that were by African-American playwrights or that featured African-American stories or characters. When the change was made, the theater initially lost many of its longtime subscribers. However, Center Stage persevered and eventually replaced those subscribers with patrons who embraced the new programming philosophy and values of the theater. Likewise, through its theatrical diversity project, Pasadena Playhouse has seen a similar evolution in its patron base as a result of programmatic shifts it has made. Leading arts groups are now actively diversifying and expanding their aesthetics, transcending disciplinary boundaries or challenging historic conceptions about what constitutes art in order to become more relevant to their changing communities. Notably, a key to Center Stage's success was that it didn't simply change the programming. It also changed its promotions and communications. Radical hospitality means we also need to think carefully about who we're for, and we can't be neutral about that, and the values we uphold, and whether or not these are being communicated and upheld in our messaging. What do I mean by that? As an example, here's a brochure by an opera company in the US. What are the first things I notice? For one, people featured in this piece are wearing black tie clothing. What else? The word insiders. So it's all well and good that the tickets are not very expensive, but what does this photo signify about who is or isn't part of the opera? And what are the values being triggered in the people responding to this brochure? Inclusivity or its opposite? Put another way, are the images and texts that you use to appeal to people further perpetuating cultural divides by signaling to some members of the community that they are not really part of the club? UK author and arts leader Julia Rowntree once commented to me, "Arts organizations are one of the few places that have the capacity to bring people together across divides on equal terms." Her comment stopped me in my tracks. If that's the case, I thought, then isn't it radically important that we do this? I think it is. Number three. Come on. I don't know. There we go. Be the kitchen table, be the campfire. So Russell Willis Taylor, who for years ran the leadership organization National Arts Strategies, gave a talk last year, and a comment she made has stayed with me. She said, "A community isn't just an audience. A community talks back, and it criticizes, and it challenges, and it questions, and it reshapes our organization to fit its needs, or it walks away if we will not listen." Russell's right. A community isn't just an audience. And if we don't want the community to walk away, then I believe we need to be the campfire, be the kitchen table, so to speak, that can hold the space for an ongoing conversation by and with the community. And I want to give a couple of examples of arts organizations that are doing this. Led by Melanie Joseph in New York, for two decades, the Foundry Theater has produced some of the most exquisite theatrical experiences I have ever taken part in. Parallel to producing great theater, the Foundry also hosts an ongoing dialogue series that brings together artists and other citizens to discuss important social issues of our time, like water, gentrification, and hunger. Melanie Joseph is not torn between making beautiful art and being an activist, working to disrupt the status quo. She is both. She is an activist aesthete. Second, a few moments ago, I mentioned Center Stage Theater in Baltimore. Director Kwame Kwe Arma replaced Irene Lewis when she left. When Kwame came to the US in 2011 from Britain, he asked 50 writers to write him a monologue about America entitled My America. When he recently repeated the exercise, issues around Black Lives Matter emerged as a theme. So Kwame commissioned six new plays, each written in direct response to recent police killings across America. Each play was filmed in the location of one of the killings, and each took place around a metaphorical kitchen table. Kwame is quoted in the newspaper saying, "The uniting element, the American kitchen table, is a place where honest discussion can happen." This was also the aim of an event that Center Stage hosted, a live event. Baltimore citizens gathered to discuss the six plays, which were live streamed on YouTube, and to engage in a discussion about the topic, Black Lives Matter. I love these initiatives because they are built around the understanding that the arts have a fundamental role to play in drawing people together, not only to spectate, but to reflect, discuss, debate, and imagine together. Now, of course, not every conversation needs to be political or focused on the big issues of the time. Sometimes the conversation we need to foster needs to be more intimate, more lighthearted, more like, you know, hanging around the campfire. When the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston decided it wanted to do a better job of reaching young professionals who had never visited the museum, it created an evening event built around the idea of a salon. They had brief gallery talks, social games that encouraged visitors to explore the museum's collection and share their observations with each other, a bar, and live music. The after-hours events now regularly attract capacity crowds of 800 young adults per month, 90% of whom visit the galleries and say it's their favorite part of the evening. What I particularly like about this program is the focus on keeping the art at the center of the social experience, making it a catalyst for connection between people. Deborah Cullinan, the executive director of the Yerba Buena Center for the Arts, wrote a blog post a few months back now titled, What if arts centers existed to ignite radical citizenship? I love this question and the vision that it promotes. We need to create the space for conversation about the ideas that matter to our community. Why? Because in a time of uncertainty marked by environmental, economic, and geopolitical vulnerability, the conversation enables artists and other community members to come together to share their stories, fears, hopes, values, knowledge, and to imagine and create a more beautiful future together. The conversation is what shifts us from having a transaction to having an interaction. The conversation is what connects us between ticketed arts events. The conversation is what connects us even when the art event itself or other things happening in the world divide us. The conversation is what creates community. Number four, focus on impact rather than size, form covenants rather than contracts. So, who, you may be asking yourself, are these two serious-looking guys with their V-neck sweaters and their geeky eyewear? Their names are Yulan Wang and Seth Rossner. And about 5 years ago, I read a New York Times article examining the remarkable success of their avant-garde jazz label called Pi. The story caught my attention because at the time, many music labels were struggling, but Pi was having great success. How did they do it? There were four lessons I gleaned from this article. One, Pi only works with artists it loves and gives every artist ample resources, attention, time, and support to make great work. Two, Pi releases only a handful of albums each year, and virtually everything it releases meets with critical acclaim. It has a great reputation, a clear niche, and because of these, a devoted fan base. Three, given the small number of albums it releases and the limited market for avant-garde jazz, Pi keeps its admin very low. By staying small, they have been able to maintain artistic integrity. Four, Pi measures its success based not on the size of the market, but on whether it is keeping its jazz fans happy and gradually developing new jazz fans. These four mutually reinforcing aspects of Pi combine to create a sustainable model. Put another way, Pi's success reminds us why small can be beautiful. Small can be better. Rather counterintuitively, in the nonprofit arts and culture sector, 99-seat theaters aside, we seem to have a bias against small organizations. But in a world where agility is needed to respond to a rapidly changing environment, and where technology has made it possible for people to organize without having to form large, formal, geographically based organizations, maybe it's time to recognize the strengths of having a sector made up of hundreds or thousands of small enterprises, each with a clear focus and a base of fans. Here's another example of a small niche arts organization, this one focused on the classical canon that has survived a long time by cultivating a loyal patron base. The Bach Choir of Bethlehem is a nonprofit festival that has been operating continuously since 1912, and it has a unique patronage model. Since its inception, the choir has employed a system of guarantees which give patrons the opportunity to book tickets and choose their seats according to the number of years in a row that they have supported the choir with an annual minimum pledge. While the pledge is made in advance of the festival, it is not payable until after the festival. And here's the really interesting aspect from my perspective. At the end of the season, guarantors are rarely asked to pay the full amount that they pledged. Most years, they're asked to pay only a portion of their pledge, an amount based on what the choir actually needs to balance its budget. In other words, the Bach Choir of Bethlehem controls its expenses and then offers to redistribute its surpluses to its fans. It uses only what it needs for now, trusting that its fans will be back the following year to again provide support. By doing this, the choir is continually earning, strengthening, and reciprocating the trust of its patrons. A key lesson of both Pi and Bach Choir of Bethlehem is this. Fans don't want to be customers. As the owners of the Liverpool football team recently learned, the first photo shows the ambitions of the managers and owners of the team. It reads, transforming fans into customers, their goal. The second photo shows the response from their fans, supporters, not customers. I would characterize the relationship that Bach Choir of Bethlehem has to its guarantors and Pi has to its fans as a covenant rather than a contract. New York Times columnist David Brooks wrote several months back, a contract protects interests, but a covenant protects relationships. People in a contract provide one another services, but people in a covenant delight in offering gifts. If we want to matter more to people, we need to make covenants with them. As UK audience development expert Andrew McIntyre recently commented, it's hard to love, support, belong to, donate to, volunteer, or advocate for an organization that only wants you as a customer. We begin to treat our fans like customers when we become more interested in the money they represent than in the gift of their presence. Be cautious of growing so large that you're forced to demand more from your true fans or the community at large than they are willing to give you. To be sustained, relationships need to be good for both parties, which brings me to my last recommendation. Go back. All right. Number 5, create scaffolds of meaning making rather than money making. This is a graphic published by Target Resource Group, a high profile and highly successful arts marketing firm in the US. Here's how it describes the goal of increasing patron loyalty on its blog. We love loyal patrons. Why? Simply put, they make money for arts organizations. And they make arts managers' jobs easier. This graphic is what I mean by a scaffold of money-making. As the last section tried to convey, we have got things entirely upside down if we love our patrons, first and foremost, because we love their money. How does it feel if you think about being the patron in this scenario? Do you feel loved? Or do you feel a bit objectified? Not only is there something much more valuable that we need from our patrons than their money, this sort of philosophy upheld over time will invariably orient an organization toward caring more about those who can buy more tickets and donate more money. So, what might we do instead? Here's an example from the Yerba Buena Center for the Arts, which instituted a new program several years ago called YBCAU. The program began with 3 goals. To increase frequency of attendance, expand the diversity of experiences for participants, and build a community around art. And it has been successful on all 3 counts, and here's how it works. For $15 a month, you get access to a slew of cultural and social events at YBCA and other organizations around the city. But here's the part I love best. When you sign up with the program, you take a survey and then receive a call inviting you to come in and meet with your own personal art coach. This staffer does essentially an intake. He or she talks with you about your goals, your history with art, which may be none or quite extensive, gets to know you, and then helps you begin to come up with a customized cultural immersion plan for enhancing your creative life. And here's an interesting tidbit. The brilliant staff member who designed this innovative program came from a background in public health. He adapted the case management model to arts engagement. This is a scaffold of meaning making. By the way, very little of YBCA's income comes from ticket sales. According to their annual report, a majority of their income comes from 4 sources: rental of their facility by community groups, raffle ticket sales from their own raffle, city government, and other sources of contributed income. The point? Investing in meaning making does result in money making, but in a way that reinforces the sense of YBCA as a public good. Like other examples I've given today, their model has structural integrity because there is an economic, aesthetic, and ethical logic that underpins it. Here's another example of creating a scaffold of meaning-making, but in another sector. As some of you may know, the slow food movement was launched in 1986 as a response to the emergence of McDonald's in Rome and the spread of the values and practices of the fast food industry and big agribusiness. The movement, at its heart, was about changing people's relationship to food through a range of strategies, including taste education, which is aimed at reawakening and training the senses and encouraging the study of food and its production. Importantly, when you shop at the local farmer's market, you're not just exchanging $10 for a hunk of cheese. You're exchanging values and knowledge. If you're a member of Slow Food, you shift from being a food consumer to being a co-producer, someone making choices on a daily basis that support the movement's goals. Consider for a moment the enormous impact the Slow Food movement has had over the past three decades. How much more we think about what and how we eat and where our food comes from today than we did in the 1960s and 70s when I was growing up. Compare that to what has happened with the arts over the same period of time. Importantly, slow food is a move back to principles and practices that were in place before the Industrial Revolution. It represents an understanding that what we once called progress was not progress once we factored in the environmental, human, and cultural costs. It's the same with the arts. Much of what we called progress in the arts in the past 50 years was a move that took the arts out of the day-to-day lives of people and made them something precious for the cultured few. In the US, we are overdue in the arts for a movement that will fundamentally change the way our communities at large relate to the arts. We need to embrace some principles and practices that were in place before professionalization, and with it, corporatization. One brief personal anecdote. There we go. In 2015, I taught a course in beauty and aesthetics for business school students. If you're wondering why a business school would say yes to someone proposing to teach a course in beauty, then you need to understand that over the past couple decades, while the arts sector has been learning to become more business-like, business types have been trying to become more like us, more cultural, more communal, and more authentic. In any event, when I designed the beauty class, I actually started with two models in mind, the YBCA model, the YBCAU program, and the slow food movement. So one of the experiences I assigned to the beauty class students was to visit an exhibition of contemporary Chinese art at the Chazen Art Museum. This is one of the pieces that they encountered by artist Susan Ping. Before looking at the title of the piece, one of the beauty class students observed, "Where is this guy going? He looks like he's striding into hell." And I chuckled. The piece is called Busy People Number One. And I remember thinking, yes, that is exactly where constant busyness and a relentless focus on business can lead us. Virginia Woolf writes in her book, Three Guineas, "If people are highly successful in their professions, they lose their senses. Sight goes. They have no time to look at pictures. Sound goes. They have no time to listen to music. Speech goes. They have no time for conversation. They lose their sense of proportion, the relations between one thing and another. Humanity goes." We've made tremendous administrative progress the past 50 years. We have learned how to hustle ticket sales and contributions and balance our budgets much of the time. But how well is this serving our longer-term goals? Christy Edmonds at UCLA once commented in an interview, "When in history did we begin to celebrate and honor administrivia and spreadsheets above literature, painting, dance, music, theater, sculpture? The contributions of artists to human awareness." Oh, sorry. Quite possibly, when we started to place our collective institutional report cards up on the national fridge and ask for applause. Sorry. So, those are five ideas for how we might more meaningfully engage with our communities, but there's a bit more. There's a last section with some concluding remarks, if you will. I mentioned earlier that there seem to be two paths before arts organizations, one calling us to embrace the market, the other calling us to embrace a different value system. In a similar vein, internet guru Seth Godin says, there's one view of the world called the Walmart view that says that what all people want is as much stuff as possible for as cheap a price as possible. And that's a world based on scarcity. I don't have enough stuff. How do I get more stuff? There's a different view, which is the view based on abundance. And in an abundance economy, the things we don't have enough of are connection and time. Which worldview guides your organization? Which will guide it in the future? The one defined by scarcity, where our audiences are relegated to spectating, where our marketing mix reinforces societal divides, where people show up every 2 years to consume some art, where what matters is how many people like your Facebook page or buy tickets to your shows, where art is a private good exchanged for cash, where you love your patrons in relationship to how much money you can get from them, and where the arts are valued because they are perceived to be an engine of the economy? Or are you going to embrace the one defined by abundance, where the community is invited to co-create, where the arts fulfill their unique role of bringing people together across divides on equal terms, where the community gathers around the campfire to understand itself, where what matters is how much impact you have, where art is a gift exchanged between people in a relationship, where you're interested in being part of someone's meaningful lifetime journey with art, and where the arts are a common good, valued because they are the way we share with one another what it means to be human. Two worldviews, one that embraces the market and one that embraces the community. New York Times columnist David Brooks argued last year in one of his columns that there are forces coursing through all modern societies that, while liberating to the individual, are challenging to social cohesion, meaning the willingness of members of society to cooperate with each other in order to survive and prosper together. Friends, I believe this is our crisis today, not just in the arts, but in our neighborhoods, cities, states, regions, and country as a whole, and it has been for some time, and we need to wake up to it. Who better than the arts to contribute to the fostering of community and social cohesion? What's at stake if we don't? Without trust, many other systems, including a well-functioning economy, cannot be sustained. And on the flip side, as pop tech's Andrew Zolli argues, disruptions in our globally interconnected economic, climate, geopolitical, and food security systems are here to stay. And one of the ways we can build resilience and the ability to weather such storms is by emboldening the local and a sense of community. I would argue that this is the great work of the arts, or a big part of it, at the very least. Our communities need us to resist the market and uphold a different value system now and always. As Rebecca Solnit says, this problem isn't going home. I took this photo when I was at a Common Cause retreat. Common Cause is an organization that encourages nonprofits to work together to advance a common set of compassionate values. At this residential training, we lived in eco huts in a remote part of Wales, and at the first gathering, we sat in a circle and talked about why we had chosen to be there. And here's what I said. I'm here because I'm trying to figure out what I'm laboring for that transcends arts and culture. I'm here because I feel like I've been talking in a closed circuit, and I want to join up the conversation we're having in the arts with the conversation others are having about the environment or human rights or education. I'm here because I don't know if I can continue to work on behalf of the arts if the arts are only interested in advancing themselves. I'm here because I'm worried about things like growing income inequality, and I suspect that growing income inequality may actually benefit the arts. And what are we going to do about that? I'm here because I'm worried about cultural divides and that the arts perpetuate them more than they help to bridge them. That realization at that event has inspired much of my writing and thinking the past few years, including the ideas in this talk. I believe the arts are a force for good, but I believe we may need to change as leaders and as organizations in relationship to our communities for them to be so. Here is a question you might ponder sometime. What are you laboring for that transcends your organization and your position within it? What values, goals, or progress in the world? Indeed, what are we all laboring for in the arts? What's the change we want to see? How about less injury and more beauty in the world? When I asked the business students taking the beauty class to write to me and tell me how, if at all, the course was changing them, one student wrote, "This course is transforming us into people who care." That's what the arts have the ability to do. It's the writer Jeanette Winterson who says that art is a different value system, and the writer Bill Sharp who asserts in his book that art is the way we share with one another what it means to be human. Do we believe them? Are we game for that work? If so, then that's where we need to put our attention. Finding the resources to do what we do is necessary, but it's not the point of our existence. Our concern is relevance. Our concern is mattering. Hustling ticket sales and contributions won't get us there. I trust that you are all working very hard to engage your communities. Look at how many examples I gave today came from this great state, and I could have discussed many more. So congratulations. Nevertheless, I challenge you to ask yourself, where can we be better? I encourage you to walk into your communities with your eyes wide open to see the relations between one thing and another, and to allow this seeing to transform how you think and how you act. Thank you for your kind attention.